Century of service. That describes the contributions of the Delta Branch Experiment Station at Stoneville. In cotton research alone, the station's reputation spans the globe. Cotton growers from Egypt to Australia may not know much about the state of Mississippi, but they've all heard of Stoneville. The Delta Branch Experiment Station is now one of the largest agricultural research facilities in the world. It presently covers over 4,300 acres of land and has a budget measured in millions of dollars. But it hasn't always been that way. Seeing the need to learn more about crops, soils, and animal production in the Delta, the Mississippi Legislature approved Senate Bill No. 22 on February 20, 1904.
Be it enacted by the legislature of the state of Mississippi, that the Board of Trustees of the Mississippi Agriculture and Mechanical College, located near Starkville, are hereby authorized to establish a branch agricultural station at some point in the state in what is known as the Yazoo and Mississippi Delta.
While the legislature may have authorized the establishment of a research station, they did not appropriate any funds to purchase land. It had to be donated. After several months, a group of progressive Washington County landowners paid $15,000 in cash to Betty J. Skinner and Joshua Skinner for 200 acres of land located near the village of Stoneville. At the time, the land was considered to be a worn-out plantation. Nevertheless, the trustees of the college accepted the land, and the legislature appropriated $3,000 for the operations budget for the first year. The Delta has always been known for growing cotton, and the Delta Branch Experiment Station has always been involved with cotton research. The very first research bulletin published by the station, the Report of Work at the Delta Station for 1906, discusses different cotton varieties, the importance of row spacing, and the value of shallow cultivation in achieving the best possible cotton yields. Growing cotton in the early 1900s was a difficult task. It required a lot of hard manual labor and a lot of mule power to work the fields. Mules have to eat, so growing animal feed became a high priority. By necessity, forage crops and feed grains became a vital secondary crop in the Delta. Consequently, the experiment station performed many tests and research projects on clover, alfalfa, wheat, corn, and oats. In fact, oats played a major role in saving the entire experiment station during one particular time of peril and struggle. In 1916, Governor Theo G. Bilbo vetoed the appropriations bill for several branch experiment stations.
I am firmly of the opinion that the time has come for the final abolishment of the branch experiment stations at Holly Springs, Stoneville, and McNeil. The amount of good derived is not commensurate with the amount of money expended by the state. These stations have signally failed to reach and benefit the great mass of the people throughout the 80 counties in Mississippi. Governor Theo G. Bilbo.
A legislative committee was appointed to investigate Governor Bilbo's claims. When they visited the Delta station, the committee was very impressed with the fine crop of oats and the operation of the grain binder. They followed the binder for round after round about the field and eventually submitted a very favorable report on the station work to the governor and the legislature. In later years, a former superintendent of the Delta Branch Station and eventual president of Mississippi State University wrote,
"It might be said that a piece of binder twine held together an institution which has meant millions of dollars to Mississippi and the world." William L. Giles.
The economic impact of the Delta Experiment Station became readily apparent just a few years after the governor tried to close the station. In 1908, Mississippi produced 1.6 million bales of cotton. But during the following years, the boll weevil quickly migrated all across the southern states, including Mississippi. In the early 1920s, infestation was extremely heavy in the Delta, and close to 80% of the cotton crop was destroyed by the weevil. By 1923, cotton production in Mississippi had fallen by almost 1 million bales to a level of just over 600,000 bales of cotton. Researchers at the Delta branch feverishly worked to combat the weevil. Dusting the cotton crops with calcium arsenate at dawn and dusk proved effective, but cotton scientists also knew that another way to beat the weevil was to develop earlier maturing varieties of cotton. Breeding programs produced results. By 1925, Mississippi farmers, utilizing both chemical controls and early maturing varieties, almost doubled their cotton harvest from just 2 years earlier, picking over 1.1 million bales of cotton. Besides cotton research, perhaps the biggest impact of the Delta Branch Station is the mechanization of agriculture. The combination of machines and agriculture has always offered a lot of potential. Mechanization research and tests started as early as the 1920s, featuring all sorts of tractors, plows, discs, and other farm implements. But the simplicity of a man and a mule proved to be a tough team to beat. At the same time the newfangled mechanical gadgets were being tested, the real farm work was mostly accomplished by pure mule power. As late as 1941, research bulletins and information sheets were being published on highly practical matters, like feeding and breeding the farm work mules. But with the industrial onslaught that accompanied World War II, flesh and blood mule power was destined to give way to mechanical horsepower. In keeping with the times, the last mule disappeared from the station in the early 1950s. The large mule barn, which had once been the pride of the station, was dismantled in 1955. By 1960, the swarms of cotton choppers in the spring and pickers in the fall no longer filled the station fields. They were replaced by chemical weed control and mechanical pickers. The decades of the 1950s and 1960s saw profound changes in the agriculture of the Delta. The new technologies of tractors, machines, and chemicals demanded high levels of management. The face of the Delta was literally changed. Many acres were landformed to precise grade, and there was much clearing of forest land to make way for row crops. New crops were carefully evaluated. Cotton was still king, but no longer was the Delta's well-being based entirely on one crop. Delta Branch research scientists developed new varieties of soybeans that were genetically adapted to the growing conditions of the Delta and the entire South. Rice was introduced to the heavy clay soils of the Delta and thrived where other crops had struggled. In the 1970s, a whole new commodity was introduced to the Delta. Almost overnight, Mississippi became the nation's leader in the production of pond-raised catfish. The Delta Research and Extension Center has now completed a century of service. Over these 100 years, the experiment station at Stoneville has come a long way. Today, over 125 scientists conduct research here and are supported by over 400 highly trained staff. From the humble beginnings of 200 acres of donated, worn-out plantation land, the Delta Research and Extension Center now hosts numerous state and federal offices and laboratories, including the Northwest District Program Area, Mississippi State University Extension Service, the Thad Cochran National Warm Water Aquaculture Center, the Southern Regional Aquaculture Center, the College of Veterinary Medicine, the USDA World Outlook Board Weather Office, the Jamie Whitten Delta States Research Center, the National Biological Control Lab, the USDA Cotton Ginning Laboratory, the Delta Council, Delta Wildlife, the Delta Health Alliance, the U.S. Forest Service Center for Bottomland Hardwood Research, the USDA Animal and Plant Health Inspection Services, Memphis Grain Inspection, Wildlife Mississippi, the Yazoo Mississippi Water Management District, and the Charles W. Capps Jr. Entrepreneurial Center. And now the staff of the Delta Research and Extension Center looks forward to starting another century of service to the Delta, to Mississippi, to our country, and indeed to the whole world.